Gartner is forecasting that global spending on cloud services is going to increase by 20.4% in 2024. So we're seeing continued growth, and it's already a very big market. So we're talking about a market of hundreds of billions. So 20% growth is quite significant. AWS is the number one cloud, so 34% of the market share. In fact, if you just look at IaaS alone, it's over 40%, and a lot of workloads actually sit on IaaS today. Now, to compare that with the next best cloud, or the next biggest cloud, I should say, is Microsoft Azure. That comes in at number two with 21% share. So if you look at the IaaS market, it's actually about half the size of AWS. So AWS, the biggest, the broadest range of services, and therefore you would say that there's the biggest job opportunities are there. There's going to be more jobs because there's so much more spend going into the cloud. So definitely continued growth happening. And with that, we're seeing AWS as being the place to be. And to put it into some numbers, it's in 2022, almost $500 billion of spend in public cloud. It went up to almost $600 billion in 2023. And Gartner are forecasting that to rise to $725 billion in 2024. Now, I know some of these numbers are a bit boring to some people. We're kind of thinking, well, how does that affect me? What does it matter to me? Well, the reason I bring that to you is because we hear about a lot of negativity, obviously, in the news all the time. People are saying that, well, the stock market is down. You know, there's talk of, well, there are wars breaking out. There's all sorts of negativity. And so you have to then go and actually look at the facts. Go to people like Gartner. Companies like Gartner, they're very good at forecasting. They have all the data. They speak to the right people. They know what's happening in the industry. So they paint a very different picture, which is that the cloud is continuing to increase, and that means more jobs. In fact, if you just look at unemployment in the US, it's the lowest it's ever been. So it's not as bad as certainly the media would like to paint it. Another graph from Gartner here. So this one, you can see, if you look at 2023 there, so that's where we are today, that's $655 billion, the blue bar, that's the spend in cloud. And the $805 next to it, that's enterprise IT spending in traditional IT, so outside of the cloud, data centers and the equipment that we put into them. And you can see that by 2025, it switches the other way. So now cloud is overtaking traditional IT. And that trend will just continue. Traditional IT is certainly becoming less popular. Companies need to move into the cloud. And we'll give you some of the reasons for that shortly. Looking at another, that was a Gartner forecast. Looking at McKinsey, well, they say that 60% of enterprises will have their, enterprises expect to have 60% of their environment in the cloud by 2025. Okay, so there's still more to go. Even then, there's a lot more growth to happen because there's still a large amount of resources that are running outside of the cloud. And over time, a lot of those will move into the cloud. In fact, another McKinsey, some data from McKinsey here as well, saying that cloud adoption could generate $3 trillion in EBITDA value by 2030. Now, that's basically profit. It just means net profit that's coming from cloud adoption. So a huge number. And you know what I want to get across to you here is that this is not a dying industry. This is a growth industry. It's early days for the cloud. It's really coming into maturity. Businesses are getting to a point where they realize that it's very important for them to start moving their workloads into the cloud. That's where they need to be.
And even more than that, when you start looking at a lot of businesses where they have a new idea or a new thing they want to throw out, they're not looking at, okay, let's get us a big server. Let's rack it up. Let's get some network fiber pulled in here. They're not going in that direction. They're immediately going to the cloud because you can jump in so fast and test your product, test your idea. And it's where the idea of failing fast comes from. You don't want to spend a lot of money. You don't want to spend a lot of time if nobody wants whatever thing you've thought up. You want to shut it down quickly. Cloud lets these companies do that. So exactly. This is just continuing. There's no slowdown on this.
And then looking at AI, you know, we wanted to talk to you about AI and what is the impact of AI in this? Well, you know, those are just the statistics which Gartner forecast and McKinsey, and I guess they probably partially take into account the growth that they're expecting to see in terms of generative AI, but they probably don't fully reflect it yet because a lot of these services really just come into fruition and into the public mindset, in the last 12 months or so. Mm-hmm. A lot of CIOs, they kind of knew it was there, but they didn't know too much about it. And now they're saying we need it. Why is it going to generate or drive more workloads into the cloud? So companies want to leverage the combination of machine learning, analytics, and generative AI services that are in the cloud. OK, Okay, so companies like AWS, they've invested heavily. They've been developing various machine learning and analytics services for years. And they've already had AI for years as well. Lots of these services that you see in the machine learning category today on AWS are actually AI services. They're pre-trained services. So use cases, you can see things like chatbots, virtual assistants, recommendation engines. You've got code generation, of course, creating code for developers, massively making them more productive. Natural language processing, report generation. You've got product development as well. You know, what if you want to bring your new idea to market? How much faster and how much better can you make it if you're utilizing AI versus using traditional techniques?
It's on that one, Neil, it's just crazy to me now that I've started using it. It's like, you have to use it. You've got to use it. Just the speed at which you can increase a rollout on anything whatsoever using AI it's a game changer. So the idea that it's out there, you've got to use it, y'all. You've really got to use it. We're going to talk about some different ones and how it's actually applicable in just a moment, but absolutely. And the thing is that because cloud has become so important, you as an engineer, you as a developer, you as an architect, you need to know about these tools and how you can leverage in that space, but with a little bit of an asterisk that we'll talk about in a little bit.
That's right. And you know, one of the things that I've heard people saying quite a lot, which is that it's not that AI is going to take your job, it's that the people who utilize AI the best are going to take your job. So, we need to make sure that we're proficient with using these tools because that's the cutting edge of technology. So in fact, what we're talking about today, we're not actually telling you to become AI experts or machine learning experts. Mm-hmm. We're telling you that these tools are going to represent further growth in the cloud and more job opportunities. And what you need to do, you don't necessarily have to specialize in AI. It just means more jobs in the cloud. It just means more companies are moving to the cloud to utilize these services. And yes, lots of opportunity if you want to specialize in that. I think if I was early in my career now, I would almost definitely be wanting to specialize in AI and machine learning and analytics because it is one of the most exciting areas to be in today. But you don't have to. You can just build that skill set so that you can get jobs working in the cloud. Companies are going to need solutions architects, DevOps engineers, and cloud engineers.
I think we were talking earlier about that, Neil. Some folks that I know that work in a major bank, actually, during their hiring loop, one of the questions they're now asking is, how are you using AI as a cloud engineer? And the funny thing about it was, and this is something I was telling Neil, everyone, was that they don't even know the right answer themselves. All they want to hear is, are you engaging in AI in your daily tasks? So it may not even be building your own LLM or anything like that. It's just, you've got to know about these things. You've got to know how to leverage them and use them. Because what Neil said, and I hope y'all really heard that, it's not that it's going to take your job, but the person who's using it can take your job. So don't let that happen. Get ahead of the curve here and make yourself really valuable with these tools.
Absolutely. And what are some of these tools as well? So we can have a look. Let me just make us a bit smaller. There we go. So we've got some generative AI and machine learning services and then data analytics. So for example, now this is not everything. This is just showing you some of what exists on AWS. You've got Bedrock and Titan. So these are like foundational models. Think sort of enterprise GPT in the cloud. You've got Code Whisperer to write code and check code and make sure that it's secure. SageMaker for analytics and predictive analytics. You've got Lex, you've got chatbots, you've got Comprehend, you've got DevOps Guru to check your DevOps pipeline and look at it and try and predict any problems that might occur before they actually happen. And then you've got data lakes, search services, you've got analytics services like Kinesis, you've got lake formation for creating data lakes. So like I said, this is just a subset of what's on AWS, but the point is all of these services exist, and that means that companies need to move their data into the cloud. Okay, it's no good if you have your data in your data center and your applications in your data center, and you want to bring out some new chatbot service, or you want to run some specific search on your data. You need to load it into a data warehouse using Glue and Redshift, or you want to start creating a foundational model and training it on your data. Try and build that stuff in on premises. It's going to take you months, years, potentially millions of dollars. It's very difficult to do.
It really is. And in some cases, it may not even be possible. Like, as I look through the list, Like one of the ones that jumps out to me, because we did a project this, but before I came here, I was at Amazon for about 3 years. We actually did a project called, it's completely slipped my mind what we called it, but basically here was the idea of it. Can we train a model? Can we train an AI system to recognize logs in the water? And the reason that came up was because people hitting logs up and around Seattle, it was actually a constant problem. So we used recognition to build a model that ran on a device that they could actually sell out to customers. The point being that you as an engineer, you as an architect, just you as somebody who sees an issue out there that needs to be solved, knowing about these tools, knowing they're there and knowing how they work could drive you to that solution a lot faster versus what Neil just said, which is like, okay, let's bring all this stuff on-prem. Let's try to do all this stuff. You're going to get to the end of into a solution much faster if you know and understand these sort of services.
And another point is, if you are a company and you have developers and they're writing code and you're creating your applications, you obviously have a lot of source code. Now, you do not want your developers taking that source code and pasting it into ChatGPT so that they can get some assistance. Mm-hmm. So companies, yes, there's certain things that you can do with ChatGPT, but remember, it's you don't own it. There's no security, really. You don't really know what's happening behind the scenes. They are learning from the prompts that you put in. So companies are already starting to enact policies to say, you know, this is what you can and you cannot do. And a lot of those are quite restrictive at this point in time because they don't fully understand this technology and they're very concerned about security. They're very concerned about leaking their IP.
Exactly. Talking to a buddy of mine who works in the defense realm, they're absolutely to the point of saying, look, you can use those tools, but it better be on a completely separate network, which means that if it spits out 200 lines of code, you're manually doing it and then you're not going back in the opposite direction. I think Chris right there has a great point about how many, a lot of large companies have completely banned access to these tools. And I don't think that's the right approach. The right approach is what Neil was just saying. Develop a policy, develop a procedure, bring those tools in, really make your teams run faster, find out, security stuff where the chat can do it, but then watch your IP. Don't be loading up all your, super code in there. Go the other way. Exactly. We just had somebody pop in there, like a sandbox environment. Exactly. Exactly the idea. Get the gist of what you're doing. But all of that is built on how good are you as an engineer, as a solid core engineer? Do you get cloud? Do you understand how all this stuff works? So you know the places you shouldn't go and when these machines make a mistake and give you the wrong answer to a question.
And they certainly do. They certainly do that. Yeah, that's absolutely the case. And that's why, companies will be leveraging AI. I think that this is going to drive further growth into the cloud because they're going to realize that if they want to be competitive in their industry, they want to develop new services, meet their customer needs better, then they're going to need to do this. And a lot of time it's driving insights as well, understanding their customers, understanding what they should be doing and getting some advice, if you like, from the AI. That's kind of what we're doing these days. Exactly. So it becomes more and more important, but they can't just pump it into ChatGPT. They must find ways to secure their IP. Mm-hmm. And that usually means moving it into the cloud so that you can then create your own enterprise GPT or utilize something, a service that does not leak that data out to, unknown third parties.
Right. Exactly. Exactly.
So that's essentially what we see happening in the market. I think it's a very exciting time. I sometimes think of that there's a good quote from Warren Buffett where it's an investment quote, but he says, "Be greedy when others are fearful, and fearful when others are greedy." And it kind of applies here as well. And the reason being is there's a lot of hype in certain industries and markets. Mm-hmm. And that is when everyone gets excited and they get in there. And that's when the competition is at its greatest. It can be at times like this where things are a bit quieter. It's a bit more subdued because of the economic climate and what's happening in the world today, which is understandable. But the opportunities are there and they're coming and they haven't gone away and they're going to grow. And I think they're going to continue into the future. Absolutely. And you need to know this. If you're thinking, well, I want to make a career change into the cloud, or maybe I haven't even worked in technology before, or you're transitioning from traditional to cloud. You want to know that there's a future. You're investing time and money, so you want to know that there's a future in this industry. And I think it's very, very clear that there really is.
It's the thing that drives me more on than anything on this, Neil, is the fact that like when I look at services like this, if I've got a system that could leverage this sort of service. If I'm in the cloud, it's like right around the corner. I can just call it and it's right there. Versus if I'm just traditional, I'm not going to have that. Like you said, it could be months before I could even have a system up and running. With this in Amazon, it's just right there. We can grab it. We can run with it. And again, if it doesn't work, you can shut it down. But if it does work, it could put you just light years ahead of the competition. So that's why, again, and this is, you know, I think I'm fairly level-headed on this one. Cloud is just a fantastic way to go. And AWS, having been there, I can tell you they are absolutely committed to being the best cloud provider around. So it is a fantastic place to be going forward with your career. Absolutely. Can we take a second and address a question that is in the chat?
Absolutely. Yeah, please.
Okay. Carla asked, which of the three major cloud providers are the best for machine learning? I read today that GCP is leading in this field. That's an interesting question, because in one area, I will tell you that in my experience, what I have done talking to security teams is that's how GCP gets into the environment. The data engineers love Google and they start using Google. Suddenly the security team finds out there's an instance of their stuff out there in Google. Next thing you know, Google has been formally brought in, is made an available tool in the environment. So I see a lot of drive from data engineers to use that. However, I think the demand is huge across all three of them. In fact, I think speaking to a friend of mine at Oracle, they're even trying to make a really big play into the space as well. So to be honest with you, I think Chris, as a matter of fact, Chris Heist made a point about it. They're all just big. They're all moving in that space. I don't think you can go wrong. I think the biggest point is, though, is this: making sure you've got the skills so that you're putting workloads in the cloud to take advantage of these things. It's critical for you to being able to quickly take advantage of it.
Yeah, there are certainly pros and cons to each cloud as well. In terms of just like the overall market, that's one of the things I think is interesting when you're thinking about, okay, where do I train initially? You can always learn Google and Azure later on, but AWS being, you know, close to 40% of the market. And by the way, Google Cloud are 7% and Alibaba are bigger. And Google used to be third. Now they've dropped fourth. And I think Huawei are like, you know, halfway to catching up with Google Cloud. So they're not, you know, they're certainly not growing. They seem to be, if anything, they're getting overtaken by others. So it's a bit more niche. I would say it's more of a niche skill set. And niche skill sets can be fantastic. You know, I think if you remember like 20 years ago, if you were an assembly programmer, you could earn a ton of money. It's dead. So, you know, I'm not saying that Google Cloud's going to go that way. I don't think they will. I think they're going to be around for a long time. And you never know with some of the services they develop and AI and stuff, they could turn it around and suddenly grow massively. But they've got a hell of a lot of catching up to do to take the market share from a giant like AWS.
They really do. And I think I was predicting a couple of years ago that if they don't move quickly, they are going to become a niche provider. That's just how it's going. They're going to be really strong in three or four areas, and people will consume those services almost as API calls, but they're never going to have that giant infrastructure like AWS or Azure, although AWS is just gigantic.